We come now to our second half of our third and final session. We are continuing the theme fruitful and faithful and are still focusing on Acts 2, 42 to 47. In our previous session, we focused on the early church being devoted to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. After listing the things that they were devoted to, we read, "Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles." So our sixth key is awesome wonders. In the early church, the miraculous work of Jesus was continuing through the apostles. Think of the people who live and work around your church building. How many of them would consider your church to be a place of awesome wonders? How many of your congregation would consider your church to be a place of awesome wonders? The early Methodist societies, with their class meetings, were places of awesome wonders, with people being saved and transformed by the grace of God. Sadly, that sense of awesome wonder has been lost from many of our Methodist churches. The hymn, "How Great Thou Art," begins, "O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made." We may be full of awesome wonder at God's creative work, and we should also be full of awesome wonder at his recreative work. By his recreative work, I'm meaning the work of God in touching and transforming lives today. This can include people becoming Christians, receiving healing, experiencing miracles, freedom from guilt, release from addictions, prayers answered, and being loved with an everlasting love. If we really believe what it says in Hebrews 13:8, that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, then we should expect his awesome work to be happening within our churches in this 21st century. In the early church, they were filled with awe, partly due to the many wonders and miraculous signs. May the future church be filled with God's awesome wonders, especially his wonderful work of touching and transforming lives. Seventhly, generosity. In verses 44 and 45, we read, "All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as they had need." There was a tremendous spirit of generosity within the early church. I think they expected the final coming of Jesus to soon take place, so there was no thought of helping to provide for the next generation, nor of what could be needed for the latter years of life. Also within the early church, it seems that their spirit of generosity was for fellow believers rather than for non-believers. Acts 6 indicates that they were operating a kind of daily food bank. There was a daily distribution of food within the fellowship of believers. Many churches and charities have experienced a massive drop in income during the pandemic, and to be able to continue, need extra finance. My wife and I have been able to give some extra money to a couple of charities which are close to our hearts. If you are doing okay financially, please consider where God may be calling you to be generous in your financial giving. As Christians, we should be generous to those within our fellowships, as well as being generous to those outside our fellowship. During the COVID pandemic, many people have ended up better off financially because they haven't been out spending so much, but many other people have been worse off, and an increasing number have had to turn to food banks and similar food schemes. The Prime Minister in his Easter message spoke about the great work done in and through churches during the pandemic. Churches in the UK are known for putting the parable of the Good Samaritan into practice. The social work which flows from our churches is an expression of generosity. May the spirit of generosity which was within the early church be a feature of church life today. our generosity amidst our congregation, our generosity to those around our church buildings, and our generosity to the ends of the earth. Eighthly, sacrificial. Their generosity involved sacrifice. They sold their own possessions and goods and gave to anyone as they had need. The future challenges and changes within church life will require us to make sacrifices. It could be sacrificing some of our possessions to finance the ongoing work of our churches. It could be sacrificing some of our church traditions, which we have highly valued. It could even be sacrificing our church buildings. One of my circuit appointments was in central Cornwall, amidst the massive China clay pits and heaps. Within a 5-mile radius of where I lived, there were 10 Methodist churches. If you notice that that's an increase of from the 8 I mentioned earlier, that is because I wasn't minister of all of them. Seeing that we were in the clay area, I set up some meetings entitled Clay in the Potter's Hands. How is God wanting to reshape Methodism in the clay area? What soon became clear in those meetings was that even though most of the congregations didn't expect their buildings to remain open for more than a couple of years, none of them were willing to take the step of giving up their building and joining forces with a neighbouring church to enable new growth. If they had caught the vision of working together, they could have seen growth rather than decline and closure. Some of them seemed to think that being faithful to God meant keeping their building open for as long as they could, whereas the real step of faith would have been to join with another congregation and become a more active body of Christ. As we consider the new normal, we need to be willing to make the sacrifices which God requires of us, and such faithfulness can lead to fruitfulness. Ninthly, worship. Although the word worship does not appear in Acts 2, 42 to 47, there is evidence that the worship of God was an important feature of early church life. Verses 46 and 7 read, "Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts, they broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favour of all the people." The fact that they met together in the temple courts every day indicates that they were at least somewhat involved with the worship of God that took place there with its sacrifices, offerings, and thanksgivings to God. The 3,000 plus believers were Jews, so it would have been natural for them to participate in the worship of God at the temple. The temple courts would also have provided space for loads of people to gather together. The Temple Mount in Jerusalem, which now contains two massive mosques, has space for thousands of people to gather, and probably had lots of space in the first century as well. As we look to the new normal, I believe that the worship of God needs to be an important part of our individual lives and the life of our churches. While I have been grateful for online worship, it has provided great opportunities for me to heartily sing praises to God, but I felt it's not really been quite the same as actually being with a congregation and worshipping God together. For the first few months of the COVID-19 restrictions, my circuit did a pre-recorded service, which could then be watched any time after 10:45 a.m. on a Sunday morning. I greatly appreciated being able to worship God through those pre-recorded services. Then after a while, they began live streaming a 10:45 service. I found that joining in with the live streamed service felt different than just watching one that had been pre-recorded. Because what I was watching was live, my worshipping of God was taking place at the same time as their worshipping of God. And that added something of the sense of togetherness in what we were doing. While COVID-19 restrictions are still in place, we will still have to make the best of what worship we can get involved with, whether online, via the telephone, or in person, but of course still at present without congregational singing. Yet we can look forward to worshipping God together again. Within the new normal, we may need to embrace major changes to the style and content of our Sunday services. This could include much greater use of creative arts, painting, sculptures, dance, drama, etc. God's Spirit has given gifts of art and creativity to many people, and we need to make opportunities for these gifts to be used for the glory of God, especially within worship. Over the past year, we have got used to modern media, such as Zoom, being used in lots of different ways. On one occasion, while I was visiting my dad down in Devon, I preached from my home church in Staffordshire via Zoom. When my home church reopened after Easter, rather than run its own Sunday service, it live-streamed the circuit service onto a large screen. So we were worshipping together as those leading the live-streamed service also worshipped together. As we look to the new normal, within some of our smaller churches, we may need to be willing to join in with a live-streamed service rather than running our own service. Even if churches don't go with live-streamed services, there is the possibility of using recorded services and even recorded sermons. Many churches used to struggle to find enough musicians, organists, and preachers. They may be even harder to come by in the future. So joining in with a pre-recorded or live-streamed service may be a helpful way forward. Of course, you do still need to have people to work the technology, although it's amazing how many 90-year-olds have learnt to use Zoom and the like. If churches are struggling to find enough people with appropriate gifts and abilities to lead Sunday services, there may be a need to be willing to travel a bit further and join worship at a neighbouring church. Acts 2:46 also mentions them meeting in one another's homes to break bread and praise God. As we look to the future, we may need to be more ready to worship in one another's homes, when, of course, restrictions do allow for that. For the benefit of those who do not come back to church, we may need to go to their homes or into their gardens to worship God together. The COVID-19 pandemic has financially crippled some churches, and some church councils will make the difficult decision for the closure of their church building. The closure of a church building does not necessarily mean the closure of the church. Members can still be the Spirit-filled body of Christ within that community, worshipping together in one another's homes, in community buildings, or even in another church building. Down in Cornwall, the St Austell Bay Church decided to stop meeting together for Sunday worship and to just keep their house groups going. Some of their people missed the Sunday services so much that they joined other congregations. I also heard comments like, "Where has the church gone?" As we look to the future, I believe that we do need to find ways to continue worshipping God together, even if it is quite different than what we've known in the past. In Hebrews 10:25, we read, "Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing." The COVID-19 restrictions have caused many people to lose the habit of meeting together to worship God. Some will need a lot of encouragement to start back at church again. As the people of God, we need to find suitable ways to continue worshipping our great and glorious God. And doing this will help us to be grounded firm and deep in the Saviour's love. And finally, key 10, growth. This chapter of Acts, which begins with the coming of the Holy Spirit, ends with, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. It wasn't just the 3,000 who believed and were baptized on the day of Pentecost. More people were being saved each day. And by Acts 4:4, the number of believers had grown to 5,000. I believe that Christian churches should be growing, not declining. Within much of the Western world, the way we've been doing church over the past half a century has led to decline rather than growth. We've even come to expect decline rather than growth. I expect Methodism to decline significantly in the early part of this decade, and this is partly due to the COVID pandemic, which will mean a significant number of those who used to attend church won't come back, and there will be several churches that won't reopen. This may be slightly offset by the number of people who join churches because of the spiritual journey that they've been on during the pandemic. I'm also concerned that if the forthcoming Methodist conference approves same-sex marriage and affirms cohabiting, there will be hundreds, possibly thousands of people leaving Methodist churches. Due to these issues, half a dozen congregations have already left Methodism, and some have also left their buildings. They have either established themselves as independent congregations or joined another denomination. They are looking to buck the trend and see numerical and spiritual growth. They are seeking to be faithful and fruitful. Earlier this year, the Archbishop of York had an online meeting with Anglican clergy in the Lichfield Diocese. Speaking about changes in church life, he gave three words for the church of the future: simpler, humbler, bolder. Simpler, humbler, bolder. Somehow we need to change from watching decline to working for growth. To increase our efforts for growth will mean that we need to decrease our efforts elsewhere. It will mean that some activities within our churches will need to change or even stop so that greater effort can be put into growth. Sadly, this will mean that some won't like the changes, and some may even leave our churches. As I mentioned earlier, for the vine to bear abundant fruit, pruning is necessary. In John 15:2, Jesus said, "While every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful." Let's welcome the pruning which will enable church to be more fruitful. Many Methodist churches have focused on building up those who are already within their congregations, rather than focusing on those who are outside the life of the church. You probably heard the phrase which was attributed to William Temple: "The church is the only society that exists for the benefit of those who are not its members." The church is the only society that exists for the benefit of those who are not its members. If we really want to see numerical growth, our churches need to be much more outward looking. If we remain faithful to God, we can be fruitful for God. The early church kept reaching out to those who were not yet believers and drew them into the Saviour's love. Today we've only covered the first two chapters of Acts. I encourage you to read the rest of the book and think about the ways in which the believers shared the good news of Jesus in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. The church grew numerically, spiritually, and geographically as it spread out across the known world and then to the ends of the earth. This happened because they prayed as they waited for the power from on high which Jesus had promised. They were then filled with the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. They were devoted and they were empowered to work, witness and worship to the glory of God. As we look to the future, post-COVID-19 and post-God in Love Unites Us, we need to be devoted, prayerful, and filled with the power of God's Spirit. This will enable our lives and our churches to be faithful and fruitful. We can look forward to growth. Let us pray. Living God, we are grateful for being able to be anchored to you and for all the ways in which you have helped us navigate the storms of life in both the distant past and in the more recent past. As we look to the new normal, post-COVID-19 and post-God in Love Unites Us, as individuals and as churches, help us to navigate the challenges and changes we face. Father God, may we know that we are your beloved sons and daughters. Son of God, may we keep our eyes fixed on you, our friend, Saviour, Lord and King. Spirit of God, may we be filled afresh day by day with your presence and power. Through being anchored to you, may our lives and the lives of our churches be faithful and fruitful, and may we see awesome wonders in our lives, in our churches, and in our communities. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Saviour's love. Amen.
Thank you. This part of the conference is for healing. I just want to make certain that everybody is aware that I will be using anointing oil for this part of the service. There's no power in me, it's the power of our Lord Jesus Christ. And he wants to meet with his troubled people in this time of change within the Methodist Church, or whatever denomination you are part of. I'm going to start off with a reading from Paul's letter to the church at Rome, starting at chapter 8, reading verses 38 and 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And to bring this up to date, neither illness, neither depression, neither disillusionment, neither worry, neither spiritual dryness will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I am conscious that during this time I've spoken to many people who are physically ill. It may be because a hospital appointment has been cancelled, or maybe it is just getting old. Our Lord is still with you. I'm conscious as well that many people have been mentally struggling through the last year, not being able to meet family, have a hug, just speak to someone, or even in some cases, because they're shielding, even get out of their property. Jesus is still here for you. And many people are spiritually dry, where they've not been able to meet in church, in fellowship, or take part in the activities that they would normally take part of, and consequently they are feeling dry. So in a moment I'm going to take the oil, I'm going to pour it, and ask for our Lord to bless it as it uses it richly to meet his people. Lord Jesus, send the Spirit upon us so that just as you had water taken from the water jars at Canaan, and as it was used, it was turned into wine. Use this oil, take it and reach across the distance so that those people watching and in need may know your presence and know that you are there with them. Open their eyes again, Lord, so that they know your peace being upon them. And therefore, Lord, as we take this anointing, first of all, for those who are physically ill, Lord, pour out your healing touch upon them. And I ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that you may be at peace, not only with yourself, but also with your Lord. And I also take this oil for those who are feeling mentally disturbed or depressed. Again, I ask, Lord, that you will remind them that you love them unconditionally. You love them to bits. And again, I ask for a blessing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit upon them, that they may feel refreshed in their mind. And finally, for those who are spiritually dry, our Lord said, come to me and I will pour out streams of living water upon you. Again, I ask that the Spirit himself will refresh you with his dwelling amongst you and within you, and remind you of all that Jesus said and did. And I ask for a blessing upon you as well, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I also pray a blessing upon those that you love as well, whether family, friends, or acquaintance, that they, even if they do not know him, may meet with our Lord Jesus Christ. And so to finish this time, and thank you for listening, just a moment of silence to reflect, followed by a blessing. We're on a journey, Lord, and at times we don't know where we're going to end up, but the really good news is that you are before us with a light to shine upon our feet. Our Father's love surrounds us and keeps us. And the Spirit himself will enable us to witness to whoever we meet the only name that has eternal life, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. In a moment there will be a 3-minute video which gives further insight to the work of Methodist Evangelicals Together. Please, if you want to find out more, go to their website. If you want to know or want to make any comment about this, again, leave messages on the website. And especially if you would like more of these types of conference. Once again, thank you for listening. Thank you for being there.
What else is at the same time as powerful and as fragile as a flame? Charles Wesley wrote, "See how great a flame aspires, kindled by a spark of grace." If the conditions are right, a huge fire can spread very quickly, regardless of its small beginning. When we open the book of Acts, it can feel very frustrating, because so often the church today doesn't seem to move like a flame being fanned by the hand of God as it was then. The flame seems to be in danger of being snuffed out.
So many people think that the church over the last 250 years has been in gradual decline, and therefore it will go out of existence quite soon. And it's much more ups and downs. And I think where Wesley came in, it was a down. Right now, the church has reached a very low ebb. But things can change, and new Wesleys may arise. We will see the country re-evangelized, the church revitalized, and society transformed.
We believe that God is far from finished working in our midst.
If we're to see the fires of the church rekindled, we must draw near to Jesus in unity.
And that is the vision of Methodist Evangelicals Together.
We are a renewal movement which is Bible-based and prayer-focused. Through our conferences, publications and magazine, we encourage and equip evangelicals within Methodism to pray, study the Bible and engage in theological study.
We believe that rekindling the Wesleyan vision is still possible in our day, because the fundamental tools that Jesus uses to reach people are still with us.
Bold and fearless preaching of the gospel by faithful disciples has always been the means of spreading holiness, transforming individuals and communities from places of darkness to spiritual vibrancy.
By upholding the authority of the scriptures and the centrality of the cross, we proclaim, make straight the way of the Lord.
We yearn to see the body of Christ built afresh by renewing the Wesleyan mission, because the gospel is too good to keep to ourselves.
Unity in this mission is key, and that is why we strive to connect and build relational partnership across Wesleyan family.
By uniting and representing evangelicals at every level of Methodism, we're preparing hearts and communities for fresh evangelistic work, fulfilling the Great Commission to make disciples.
We know that raising the next generation of Wesleys is the most important contribution that we could possibly make, because the world will always need faithful messengers of the grace of God.
Though the future seems uncertain, we know the power of the Holy Spirit to transform the lives of young people.
By praying for revival and spiritual renewal, we are imitating the actions of our Wesleyan forebears, who led the greatest revival these isles have ever known, the fruits of which we are still harvesting today.
If you have a passion to see the flames of faith rekindled in your community and across these nations, we urge you to visit our website, methodistevangelicals.org.uk. Sign up to become a partner in our mission to rekindle the vision, renew the mission, and raise up the next generation of Wesleys, asking God to fan the flames of revival amongst us once again.